for The New Yorker. And I'm a resident cartoonist at CBS News, and I'm the moderator today. I'm a cartoonist who happens to be a woman. If one says woman cartoonist, you risk ghettoizing women, and indicating that we all draw alike and think alike. Of course we do not. I didn't start out as a woman cartoonist. I just wanted to draw, and I was a girl. I still believe that is the case. No matter where you live, being a woman is a daily political act. Different degrees in different countries, of course. What I love about cartoons is they can get serious about issues and be serious about issues in a subversive way. They catch people off guard. People are drawn to the cartoon because everyone loves cartoons. And then we can hit them with the humor while pointing out a hidden truth or a noxious stereotype or even more serious problems. I began as a cartoonist because I was shy and it was my way to express myself. I know now that it was also my way of avoiding fitting into the prescribed gender role. I could be the artist and do what I want and wear what I want and still feel like I fit in somehow. I found I could draw subversive ideas and not get scolded. Cartoonists look at society and mirror it. We make fun of what is right and we make fun of what is wrong. So whether it is openly clear or not, I believe gender is intimately woven into the fabric of being a cartoonist. So I brought together four really wonderful cartoonists. You'll see one is missing and I'll explain in a minute. Who are my friends and wonderful people. What's particularly interesting about the three on stage is that their work is not known as political necessarily in the traditional sense, although like I said, being a woman is a political act. So these cartoonists can at times jab at society and it can be quite effective, maybe more so because the viewer really isn't expecting it from them. So after introductions, I'm going to show and during the introduction, I'm going to show two slides of each of these cartoonists so you can get an idea of their work if you don't know it already. You probably do. And then we'll go forward with a bunch of slides that they sent me. These cartoonists sent me slides that they liked. I asked them to send me slides that were their favorites and that might tell us a little about who they are, what their work is like. And also asked them to send me cartoons that had to do with the subject of the festival, which is gender. So, here we go. So Emily Flake is a cartoonist, writer, and illustrator. Her most recent book is Mama Tribe, Dispatches from the Seamy Underbelly of Modern Parenting. Her work regularly appears in The New Yorker, Mad, and The Nib. She's also creator of Lulu 8-Ball, a long-running alt-weekly strip. So Emily, you don't have to read these.
Sure. So this one says, every guy out there is either married, gay, or a human suit zipped around a column of ants. shit, I can't read that either. I believe it says, and furthermore, it prevents all that P-word grabbing you ladies were so worked up about.
Roz Chast is a longtime cartoonist for The New Yorker. Her most recent book, Can't We Talk About Something More Pleasant? A graphic memoir about her parents' final years, was a finalist for the National Book Award for Nonfiction in 2014.
Dousing for coffee. This is self-explanatory. Wow, this really resolution is like I have
cataracts. I
know. This is The Glass Floor. Maybe if I
hold very, very still.
If I just hold very, very still, nothing will happen. You can see like how long ago this cartoon is from, because that computer is like.
Ross, just want people to know that you don't, that you're in the modern world now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Liana Fink. Liana's work appears regularly in The New Yorker, The Owl, Catapult, and on her Instagram feed. Her first book, A Bintel Brief, was published by Echo in 2014.
No calling any nonsense. It's not you, Brian, it's men.
Rayma Soprani wasn't able to get here today, unfortunately. She lives in Venezuela, but her plane got canceled after waiting on the tarmac for like 4 hours. So unfortunately, she's not with us. But I left her cartoons in the PowerPoint. And I wanted to read you just a quick few things about her, because I thinking she was going to be here, she would explain who she is with the translator and what her situation is in Venezuela, although she lives here now. But since she's not here, I put together a few words to tell you who she is and what she's about in a few words. Rayma is a Venezuelan press cartoonist who was born in Caracas. For 19 years, she published her cartoons in El Universal in Venezuela. She's a member of Cartooning for Peace Association and one of the protagonists of the film Caricaturists, Foot Soldiers of Democracy. In 2015, she gave powerful talks on the defense of human rights for Freedom House and also the Oslo Freedom Forum. In 2014, her paper, El Universal, was taken over by the government and she was pressured to drop her criticism. In September, The Last Straw is a cartoon she drew about the country's condition, indicating the country was dead and that it had died under Chavez. Under Chavez, she criticized the government, but it was somewhat tolerated. And then when military rule descended after Chavez's death, under Maduro, it is not tolerated. When asked if it's worse that she is a woman, she agrees. They say things like, quote, you need a husband to put you in your place. You're a prostitute, and worse. They say you're a lesbian, which is not acceptable there. They attacked my integrity as a woman and a human being. They denounced her on state TV, demonized her, showed her photo with Nazi symbols around her head, put horns on her head, called her a traitor, a terrorist. The murder rate in Venezuela is the second highest in the world. State TV indoctrinates people all day long and pours hatred onto the dissenters. She received death threats through phone calls and social media. She said, under Maduro, it's worse than Chavez. She finally had to leave Caracas because it's too dangerous. And she said her creativity was stifled and she felt paralyzed. Now living in Miami, she says she can, quote, draw at a distance and be more useful. Her cartoons used to be a must-see in Venezuela. Now she draws about the government but uses social media. One of her current projects is to draw pictures of current political prisoners in Venezuela and telling their stories. In her speech for Oslo Freedom Forum, which is online, you can go see it. We wanted to play today, but we didn't have the technology to do so. It's a wonderful speech. She draws about the cartoonists of Charlie Hebdo who were killed. And in this talk, she asks, does humanity think the artists brought it upon themselves? The premise of this question is disturbing. It implies that we're going back to the barbaric times when the prevailing belief was that a woman should be raped for wearing a miniskirt. Humor is a way to resist tyranny. Cartoonists have always had to confront power, both political and financial and religious, she says. So unfortunately, Rayma's not here. But she'll be here in her drawings. And I think, I don't speak Spanish, but I think this is a normal day in the life of a Venezuelan, am I correct?
Yes. Yeah.
So, let's see. I asked the panelists to send me some cartoons, and I'm going to show them now. And my main question to these guys. Main questions these guys are based on the theme of the festival. And then we'll just go into back and forth discussion about the cartoons and ask each other questions, and hopefully we'll be not stiff and serious all the time. The questions I had to throw at you to keep in your mind is, do you feel your work is inhibited or censored because you're a woman? Do you use your perspective as a woman in your work, and is there such a thing? You feel you have a responsibility to draw or write about the issues that confront women? And has power changed for women in cartooning? So, just some simple questions.
Lock those in.
But then also, just a lot of these are not about gender, they're just fun cartoons. So we'll go back and forth. So the first one is from Emily, I believe.
This is the caption here is, I miss my frog wife.
How do you call it? come up with this, haven't they?
Yeah, just thinking about fairy tales in general, and thinking about the Princess and the Frog, right? That's the title, that thing. And it occurred to me that, you know, he might have had a nice life as a frog, and, you know, gone through the whole, like, frog life cycle, and maybe when he was sort of, like, pulled back into humanity, you know, maybe he missed it. I don't know if we want to, like, want to get gendery about this. Maybe frog wife the less the bitch.
She's smaller.
Greener.
Weightless.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Better at catching flies. Actually, weirdly, not better at catching flies. All right.
Okay.
Ross?
This is the vain but realistic queen. She says, mirror, mirror on the wall, who, if she lost 10 pounds and had her eyes and her neck done and had the right haircut, could in her age group be the fairest one of all?
That's how we feel.
Yeah. I don't know what else to say about it.
It's okay, you don't have to comment on every cartoon.
Okay. I like her feet.
What?
I like her feet a lot. You never was at her level. And yeah. I wasn't at foot level with her before, and you never noticed them. Gender neutral Rapunzel. And the princess saying, or beard, let down your hair, or beard. I made this one, like, I've had, like, an awakening to gender. Horribly recently, and I made this just as I was figuring it out. I was dating a man with a beard.
You never know where your ideas are coming from.
I think it's interesting that all three of those were fairy tale cartoons.
Yeah, I did do that on purpose.
Yes, nice. I see what you did.
Yeah. Nothing else is organized, so. Yeah, it's interesting. We take fairy tales and try to. I've done some fairy tale cartoons as well. And, like, you plug in current issues into a fairy tale and it really kind of messes with the idea.
Do you guys think that women cartoonists do more fairy tale cartoons and men cartoonists do more not other trope cartoons, like Desert Island and stuff? Like, there's a lot of men who do Rapunzel cartoons, I've noticed, but, like, I feel like these are our stories and the stories that we have to make fun of because they're so horrible.
That's interesting. We're going to have to, like, run an algorithm on that later.
Yeah.
I often wondered, in the same line, like, the New Yorker has bought a lot of cartoons of mine about children, and I don't do a lot of them, but I do some maybe every batch, and I wonder if they buy them because they like them, or because I'm the only one doing them, or there's more men and they don't do cartoons about raising families, or maybe they do. I don't see their cartoons. So,
well, Bob Mankoff, our former cartoon editor, recently retired, or not really retired. This is not. I don't know what to do with this thing. Anyway, he said that. Thank you. That's smart. Bob said that cartoonists tend to fall into these two groups where they draw. There are some cartoonists who draw mostly from, like, the cartoon universe, and their cartoons are sort of, they all take place in the cartoon universe. They love cartoon tropes like desert islands and stuff like that. I don't know, I guess end of the world guys and just the cartoon tropes that exist. And then there's people who are more observational. And I think it goes across gender lines. And also, I mean, I do both, the trope ones and the gender ones. But it was interesting to sort of think about the two different kinds of cartoons, the ones that have to do with cartoon tropes and the ones that are really just kind of from, you know, something that you heard in life or something.
When I was pregnant, I was reluctant to submit any kind of like pregnancy or kid jokes or, you know, anything sort of domestic, because I didn't want to get sort of pigeonholed into doing quote unquote baby cartoons. And, you know, in a way, I almost felt like I'm putting what they don't know I'm a lady. So I didn't want to fall into doing that. And like, now that I think about it, I feel like, I mean, there was an article recently saying that like, narratives of motherhood are discounted because they're, you know, lady stuff, whereas like that's just, you know, that's just women drawing from their lives. You know, that's part of the life, your life is being pregnant, being a mom, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, between that and the fact that pregnancy and having a daughter ended up being funny, and also why have a kid if you're not going to make jokes about it?
Sometimes a certain age that becomes very tricky. It's right. Much easier when they're younger because they don't know anything. But yeah, it's I didn't do any cartoons about pregnancy because I think I was sort of too freaked out by the whole thing. But definitely, at children, there were a lot of funny things about that. And now occasionally, even though my kids are grown-ups, there are some funny things that I've done cartoons about. I remember once thinking about the Runaway Bunny, and you know, what if your kid's 30 years old? Mm-hmm. And it's like, you'll never get away from me, you know, you can run away, but, you know, I'll be there, I'll follow you.
Like that terrible I'll Love You Forever book where she straight up stalks her kid
until
she dies.
It's so awful. Yeah. You'll never escape my clutches, basically. It's terrible.
Is this the right moment?
I feel like it's worth saying that the struggles Rayma faces as a woman are very different from the struggles we're facing as women, and that's something to acknowledge. I feel like, you know, any struggles that I've been faced with as a woman cartoonist are like the equivalent of a mosquito bite.
Oh, same.
Yeah.
Same. And in some ways, I feel like, to be honest, in some ways it's been an advantage, because especially when I started, there weren't any, and it was probably when I submitted under, you know, my initial, because I think I didn't want to sort of, you know, have the added burden of like, oh, look, a lady cartoonist.
Right.
It's like sort of embarrassing. And it still freaks me out that this is an issue, because I don't think, as Liza was saying before, I don't think of myself as a lady cartoonist. You know,
right.
I'm just who I am. And even when I don't know, anyway. But as I'm sure it was not a hurtful thing, mm-hmm. you know, when I started, because probably at some point, even in the late 70s, you know, it was like, maybe it's actually kind of odd that it's all men.
Right.
You know?
Let's see what a lady has to say.
Yes, exactly. Just one. Just
right.
One. Just that one.
Yeah. You may speak for all women.
Yes, exactly. As I do. As I do. All the time.
Yes.
What do women want?
Let's see.
Real cheeks. Yes. Exactly.
When I make New Yorker cartoons, I feel like they're like, it's not a very angry venue. Like, you have to pretend to be this kind of like witty person who takes a step back and like wears tweed or something. So I have a lot of anger, but I don't channel it into my New Yorker cartoons very much. And I think on the one hand, that really limits what I have to say. I can't be myself as much as I could be if I were a remote man wearing tweed. But it's a really nice escape, because anger is pretty limiting, and I don't want to be defined by the fact that I'm a woman and that I'm very attuned to like all the very small and hard, like small and insidious ways that I'm treated unfairly, like when I walk down the street and stuff. Like, it's nice to escape from that once in a while.
Also, sometimes when I'm really angry, I think I'm being funny at the time, but then I look back and it's not funny. It's like, you know, when Trump won the election, in fact, it's very hard to get him out of my head. And, you know,
it just seems like, what is there to say? It's like I could just do a million. He's an idiot. He's an asshole. He's, you know, a stupid cheeto. You know, on and on and on. And it's not really, you know, it's nothing new. It's not that funny. And, you know, at some point you kind of go around full circle and it's like, well, I'd rather draw about, you know, frogs or something.
Yeah.
But I feel like Liana and Emily and myself, Roger, you don't publish as much on the internet as us three. We have our New Yorker work, which is, as you said, Liana, can be kind of mild, not feminist particularly, although it's subversively feminist sometimes. But then when you get on the internet, I found like when the internet hit us, I really liked the floodgates opened with cartoons that I knew that the New Yorker didn't want, but I could publish them online and I could share them on Twitter and like have a conversation with the world about that, about my anger, about the subject that I really wanted to talk about. And you guys do that, right? You publish online a lot.
Yeah, I would say I don't think that my work online is particularly, I mean, it's not necessarily more political or angry. I mean, I feel like it's weirder and coarser, I think, than the stuff that I submit to the New Yorker. So, I mean, like with any publication is gonna have its own voice. That you kind of tailor what you're submitting to, and online, I guess there's more of a variety of voices, and you know, like I do a lot of work for the NIB, and they actually do have more of a political bent. So sometimes I feel like I should be like more political with them, but yeah, I mean, the more obviously the more outlets there are, the more you can sort of like vary what you're saying. We can just pretend that I made a point.
Fascinating. People have problems with political stuff because also, for me, like, I'm not, compared to some people, I'm not that terribly well-informed. I'll think very strongly and, well, this is kind of idiotic, and then the next person will come to me and, like, give me a different point of view and say, well, you're right, you know, that was, you know, so I tend to go back and forth from I have, you know, certain strongly held feelings, but I don't know, when I'm thinking about cartoons, I don't feel like I'm a political cartoonist or that it's not something I'm really that, I guess deep down I'm not that interested. I'm interested in things that are funny, and sometimes things that are funny have, to me, have nothing to do with my political opinions.
I like politics more lately since we're allowed to fight against the men in suits. I've never related much to them.
Well, good luck, everybody. This is a page from Mama Tribe. This is birthing plans, and I'm gonna try to remember what it says. Plan A, at home, attended by a partner and team of, I'm just going to go ahead and say doulas, well-versed in your birth plan. Plan B, at a respectable birthing center attended by a trusted physician. Plan C, at the hospital by whoever happens to be on staff that night, and he's checking his phone and saying, yeah, like, you know, push or whatever. Plan D, in the bathroom of your prom, completely out of the blue. Slowly saying, like, wait, what the fuck? Is that a baby? I think that's where most of the words are.
Well, you forget that, I mean, Rob and I have been around for a while, but this kind of cartoon would not have been published anywhere. Or it's in a book, right?
Yeah, it's in a book, so kind of wasn't.
It wasn't published.
I think I might have actually submitted this or something like it to Bob. A lot of what I put in the book was rejected from the New Yorker. Because, I mean, the New Yorker is still not a place where you can have a baby on a toilet. We're working on that. But I don't think that's because it's like, you know, a feminist issue. I think it's just not okay to have a baby in a toilet.
Well,
no,
I know. The fact that you're drawing it is political.
Yeah.
Should have made her reading the New Yorker.
I mean, she is an evening wear. So. What do you do on the toilet to have a baby on the toilet? I feel like that's an Us Weekly kind of situation. I don't know. I came like this close to having my baby on the toilet. So like, yeah. I mean, I knew she was there. sort of.
This is a cartoon that I think was published in one of Liza's books. The Ascent of Man, and I guess it's the genre of the evolution cartoon, and the last one, she's just saying to the king man, bug off.
Is that you, Roz, in that drawing?
None of these people. I love that the evolutionary cycle is like turtle, alligator, horse, man. That is a rethinking of Darwinism that I am very on board with.
We'll promise you.
Great.
Look how close he's standing to her. I think it's cool.
They look ridiculous.
This is a very feminist cartoon, I think. Okay. This is Rayma.
This is another page from Mama Tried called Parenting Philosophies. I mean, if you have kids, there's a lot of conflicting philosophies you're supposed to follow, and there's like, you know, sort of 360 degrees of judgment going on anyway. So I'm gonna try to get closer to this.
Okay.
That didn't help at all.
I can read it on my computer. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, actually, can I just do that?
It's pretty small.
All right, yes. So. So this is Tiger Mom. A Tiger Mom, you guys have heard
of French?
Yeah. French prose. This child is smoking. and then there's some sort of semi-feral child, some sort of like hippie nonsense, and then, oh, and feral, where you just raise your kid in the closet. I'm somewhere between French and feral at it. Can you see through this shirt, by the way? I feel like...
No.
Thank you.
This is Afghan Gap. You have classic cargo, pleated front, flat front, slim fit with lycra, relaxed fit, and crop.
Can I ask you a personal question?
So this is a Lulu Leap Ball example. This is Netflix categories. German Scheisse rom-com. He's saying, ich liebe dich, and she says, ich liebe Scheisse. quirky, droll indie comedies that end in brutal murder.
PVR.
home videos of pet birds. And film Skynet thinks you should watch. Why is the Terminator under documentaries? Nothing even remotely feminist about that. Unless you consider Scheisse films.
What's a Scheisse film?
That is a... I'm so glad you asked. It's a subset of pornography where they smear shit on each other. Of course it's German.
Was this in the New Yorker?
No!
less shy situation. This ran all weeklies, and that's where you can do that kind of thing.
I spend a lot of time watching videos of pet birds.
Does Netflix know?
I'm sure they do. Right. You might like this.
Ross has a lot of pet birds, if you didn't know. That's a very feminist thing that you do.
Birds. This is Donna Karen's nightmare.
She asked to buy the original Donna Karen?
No, I think she probably did not like it.
They stop people sometimes.
I know when it ran, the woman who was governor of New Jersey was quite upset. It was Christy Whitman. She used it as an example in a press conference of New Yorkers bashing New Jersey. And I thought, well, I'm allowed because, you know, I'm from Brooklyn. So it was like this weird logic, kind of.
Cartesian chopped liver. What am I?
I like the little squish of liver like next to Cartesian.
Oh yeah, this was an early one. It was more decorative earlier.
What do you mean by that? You were more decorative.
Like I always put like a little surprise somewhere for people to find. I might have even like written hi in here somewhere.
That's the upper left corner. What is that?
Those are just
nuts. I'd like to know how each of you started doing what you do. We can go down the line. This is one case where we go down the line. Because I'd really like to know when you started drawing cartoons.
Yeah. I started drawing as a baby, and I think my parents praised me a lot for it, and it became my identity, and I held on to it. And then I had like, I knew that I drew, and I had like a detour into art school and realized I didn't want to make fine art, and then I came back to this.
I drew ever since I was a child, but I also wanted to write, so cartooning seemed like, you know, a good way to combine those two things. I went to art school for illustration, but that's where I really started getting into cartooning.
And I had sort of a similar trajectory. I drew when I was a little kid, when I was very small, and I think some of it had to do with having older parents who I was an only child, and they really didn't know quite what to do with me sometimes, so they would give me paper and, you know, pencils, and we lived in an apartment, and it was one way to, you know, keep me quiet and keep me occupied. And, you know, if we went out to dinner, if we went to visit one of their friends, and they brought me with, as long as I had paper and pencil, I would be occupied, and I just kind of kept doing it. And I think also, I like things that made me laugh, and I like to make myself laugh, and I like that when things were funny. That's just really important. And I noticed that even when I tried to draw very seriously, sometimes it would come out sort of strangely and kind of funny. So, you know, sort of geo with the video. You try not to, even though I do often work against it. In that case, I think it was at some point I stopped. You know, if I draw a vase of flowers or something and try to make it like serious art, it's going to come out like, hello, it's a vase with some flowers in it. Look at this little daisy. It's just going to come out weird. So, you know, why not go with it?
Being a professional cartoonist is really hard for me because I think I always drew to make fun of things, and it's like I don't feel like I can make fun of things when I'm willingly spending a few days each week making these drawings and then showing them to someone willingly and hoping that I get paid money for them. Like, it's not,
yes.
It's not the same. I would prefer if you could be a graffiti artist on very small pieces of paper and in private.
This is America. You can do whatever you want.
That's one thing about the New Yorker that was that has been so good, I think, in terms of how they buy the work, is that you do a batch of drawings, you do what you think is funny in your week, and then you submit it to them, and they buy it. They buy something, but they don't. So it's not like they're assigning you something. So yes. It's a bit of freedom, and so, you know, you can sort of try to figure out who you are and be artistic on a piece of paper. You can't get rid of those voices saying they won't buy this, they won't buy this, because they're there. But at least you can try, right?
And also, I went to art school also, and it was really, for me, I liked that when getting out of art school and becoming a professional artist, the good side of money and art is that I really did not like it in art school. I just felt like some of the criticism was so beside the point, where people didn't really understand what I was doing, and I didn't want to pay money to hear somebody's opinions about my work. I wanted to get paid. I wanted it the other way around. It's like, no, you pay me, you know? I don't want to pay you to give, you know, your biased opinions. When we submit to the New Yorker, there's not a lot of feedback, at least there hasn't been for me. It's, you know, it's really binary. It's either they buy it or they don't buy it. And I like, in some ways, the cleanliness of that. Opposed to the sort of murky aspect of art school, where sometimes I felt it also had a lot to do with whether you made friends with your teacher, whether you bonded with your teacher, whether they thought you were hot, whether they thought you were interesting, whether they thought you were smart. And I just, like, I could not do that. It was just like, really, I don't want you to have any thoughts in your head about me. I want you to really just be looking at the work, and can you use it? Great, give me the money. You can use it. Don't give me the money. It's clean, you know.
Yeah. So, I like the pragmatism.
Yeah.
I agree.
And also, if you get paid, then you don't have to do other horrible jobs, which for me, I've never done. I don't know how to operate a cash register. I mean, I don't think I could bag groceries. I just don't. There's so many. I think at some point, also being a cartoonist, I was so bad at everything else, you know, and the idea of having to go to an office is great motivation to kind of keep working and trying, you know, every week to do the best that I can do, because I'm absolutely terrified, you know, of ever having to get like a grown-up sort of job and, you know, put on an outfit or something.
How do you navigate? I mean, the binary system is helpful because it is binary and it's very clean. But I know that for me, many years I really was seeking approval, like wanting somebody to do what you're describing. And I remember, Roz, you told me that when you were first starting out, you would draw, you know, your drawings were like really tiny, because you were like, maybe if I draw really tiny, nobody will notice. So I feel like that is sort of a woman thing, a girl thing to do.
Yes.
It's like, don't look at me, you know. I'm not here. I mean, maybe I could be here, maybe I'm not here. Just hesitancy that drives me nuts.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. When I started, I drew, my boxes were not much bigger than a postage stamp, because I thought, well, I won't take up a lot of space, you know. Buy the drawing, but don't worry, you know, I'll make myself as small as possible, and, you know, I will hardly be you won't even notice a quiet, you know. Of course, it didn't work out quite like that, but it's like the opposite of man spreading. I mean, I'm amazed when I see how much confidence in some ways that men sometimes have in themselves and in their work, that I feel like one thing that as women we do a lot, and I know a lot of men who do this too, you know, a lot of self-doubt and self-criticism, and we're just never really good enough, and you know, and we suck, and it's bad that we even like do anything really, because I should just be, you know, a mom and a wife and happy with that, and you know, taking up space at all, that could be taken up by a man, that's really, you know, I feel terrible about it, I'm sorry. You know, so there is this constant, you know, pushing back
against that. I mean, when I see guys and men still on the subway, you know, when they sit and it's like, I'll just take up three seats. Yes, yes, I'm not here. Look, I'm compressed into like, I'm not even taking up a whole seat. I'm just like, and that is really a gender thing.
I think that was one of the most like excruciating things about having a baby is all of a sudden I was taking up four times much space as normal and also being loud, you know. So and you know, I don't even have a thing against being loud except for when like I don't have any control over this thing that is attached to me and screaming. Just this like this thing of like I'm being a problem was very hard.
Being a problem. You don't want to be a problem.
Right.
And I think that's definitely a gender sort of thing. I mean, there's, you know, all of this sort of like, I'm not sure if I'm going to pronounce this right, the enfant terrible, you know, of male artists who, you know, they just have people sort of, you know, well, he's just such a genius. You know, he can be a mega asshole, but he's such a genius. And it's like, I feel like for women, you know, you just better not really step out. You better not be too much of a jerk, because if you're really too much of a jerk, you know, we're letting you do this, and, you know, just don't be too much of a jerk. Just, you know, put a lid on it. So, I don't know.
I can't tell
from your face. Don't look at that.
I have to say it.
Sometimes I hate fine art. And the abstract expressionists who are supposed to be in art school, and I think that they're man spreaders, and I think that they get trapped. They get trapped in their own trap because they're stuck making the same painting over and over again, and they don't have to do that.
I feel like the initial way went out. in many ways, she's her work. Not so much this, because it's not really political, though maybe it is. She's manspreading with her work, and she's being loud with her work. And in Venezuela, it's gotten her in trouble because they don't like to be criticized. The government doesn't like to be criticized. But it's also the fact that she's a woman. She's not with the program. She's not behaving like a woman should behave in that society.
And that society is probably a lot stricter.
Yeah, definitely. When I first started drawing cartoons, I thought, well, I do political cartoons too. I can't draw about what it's like to be a woman in another country because I live here. I'm American. I, you know, got a very privileged life, and I'm white. And so, but then I began to look at women cartoonists around the globe, and we all have, on different levels, we all have the same things in common, you know, but different degrees. You know, we're all belittled in some cases, raped, underpaid, abused. So. I decided to draw about other women. But Raima's work is really really loud, and Kate, she's taking a lot of risks.
Well, that was a serious thing to say.
Right,
this
sorry.
So this is another movie. Well, this is weight loss. What's blocking you? Saying my body processes criticism as a sugar. I sleep, eat all the shit I buy while I'm awake. Fat people, fat blood. Fat blood, fat dragons. And then the last panel is, sorry, I've got pie in my ears. What was the question? I don't know what, but fat blood, fat Dracula is possibly one of my favorite 10 things I've ever seen. I straight up enjoy the writing much more than I do the drawing. I mean, I am, you know, I'm not that great drawer, and I, you know, so like when I work with that, like sitting and drawing, I am far more aware of my deficiencies as an artist than I am as a writer. Not saying I don't have deficiencies as a writer, but I don't beat myself with them in the same way as I beat myself with my deficiencies as a drawer.
Because you went to art school.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and like you were saying, I feel like, you know, I could draw when I was a kid, and that became like an identity thing, and then
And that puts a certain weight on it where, like, if I can't do this well, then who and what am I, et cetera, et cetera. Blah, 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 neurotic. But, Anyway, Fat Dracula.
I mean, James Berber didn't know how to draw.
They let him do it.
But apparently Jackson Pollock was amazing at drawing, and he couldn't have become Jackson Pollock if he hadn't been amazing at it. So it's a lesson for us all.
This is an old cartoon statue. Doris K. Elston,
brain surgeon,
model, something.
Lawyer.
Artist, lawyer, and plus mother of four.
This is probably in the 80s, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Which was
before I think I myself became a mom. The olden days.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, this is the only one that they bought that they didn't publish, and I wonder, they might have been right. It might be like phobic in some way that I can't put into words. Okay. Oh my God, Henderson's been redrawn as a woman.
I did a cartoon similar to this.
Wait, what?
I did a cartoon similar to this. It did not run in the New Yorker. It was not drawn as a woman, but there's a man coming in the room. He's dressed in a skirt and pearls, and it says, Harold's here to provide the feminist viewpoint. We got into some trouble because the transgender community
felt,
and the writers, so I think.
Yeah, I know. I felt that way about this one, too. It might be that.
So we have to adjust to these.
I just kind of thought it was a cartoonist joke.
Yeah, it is a great joke
about
drawing
and about the lack of women in
boardrooms. And I don't think he's supposed. I don't think Henderson's been redrawn as a trans woman. I think it's just any woman.
I'm going to tell you Rayma's story of starting out as a cartoonist. Apparently she was drawing, like us, drawing as a child a lot, and she would draw on the walls of her family's home. And every morning her mother would have to get out the scrub brush and soap and get rid of the drawings on the walls, but she let her do it. And finally she and her mother came to an agreement. Her mother said, okay, Rayma, you can draw on the wall, but pick one wall to draw on. And that's your wall. So she picked a wall, and she drew on that wall until it was full, and I guess she cleaned off and did it again. So
clearly that was not a rental apartment.
The years before whiteboard paint.
I remember the walls in our apartment were sacred because they were rentals when I was growing up, and like you couldn't hammer nails into them.
Right.
So you had to use those kind of hooks. Right. They had like the paste on the back, and they always came down.
Our landlord asks us for advances on the rent regularly. As far as I'm concerned, we can do whatever the fuck we want to those walls.
Yeah, that's right.
Stickers?
Sure.
This was a recent one. I'm sorry, but refusing to use an Oxford comma isn't really grounds for divorce. Which I feel like is debatable.
Is that like a bigger comma? Is that like a bigger comma?
Yeah. It's like a supersized comma.
What is it?
And somebody shout out if I'm defining this wrong. It's like the comma, like, you know, say you're describing something. And like a mean, fat, sleepy Dracula. I think if there was a comma after sleepy, I believe that's the Oxford comma.
No, I think, yeah.
No.
That, oh, okay, I don't know.
The Oxford comma is if Dracula looks mean, fat, and sleepy.
Right.
Mean, comma,
yes.
Fat, comma,
yes.
Sleepy. The comma after fat is the Oxford comma.
Yeah, she's right.
It doesn't really look different. It's just
No, it's just it's one. It's either the
it, it can change the meaning of the sentence.
Yeah.
He's shooting. He's mean and he's fat asleep.
Right. You're right.
Everybody pull out your phones. Examples of Oxford comma.
I would like fat and sleepy Dracula.
Yeah.
Not I'm a fat.
This is asexual harassment. Why would you call your mother more often? And of course, that every time you serve red meat, you increase your husband's chance of having a heart attack. And if you weren't working, you'd have perfect children like Mrs. What's her name?
She's also relatively old, right?
Yeah.
I picked some of these.
They're
old favorites.
Yeah.
Tell them that I'm very you're a good group.
So I guess what I'm saying about this is that the author is a woman. And I know that's like, you know, we get on my high horse, but like sometimes when I started out cartooning, which was ages ago, you know, I just drew the character of my cartoons and it was usually a man. And then it dawned on me, you know, late 90s, like, maybe I could make the person speaking a woman more often than not. Like, why not? A woman can be every man. So this, you've made this person, I mean, maybe it's you, sort of, but made the person the subject of the cartoon, and the person speaking is not a woman, but nobody's speaking. Anyway, you get my point, right?
And I also feel like people would dare less to do that kind of thing to a man.
Yeah.
Oh, that's true.
No, I did. I drew it as a man when I sold it, and they redrew it after they bought it.
Why did you decide to do that? You know,
I do that a lot.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Caption here is, son, if you can't say something nice, say something clever but devastating. There's a lot I hate about this drawing, but I like the joke. The child's head is like ridiculously tiny, like he looks like he's just a tiny man. Also, that slide in the background is way not up to code. That could
Yeah. What could go wrong?
Like, this thing pops up online every once in a while, and I'm just like, God damn it! You know, like, I wish I could just, like, redraw it.
Oh, I feel that way about 99%.
Did you always think of this one as a dad talking to a son, or did you think, consider putting it in a woman's mouth?
With this one, I didn't think it made a particular difference one way or the other. I mean, you could argue that if it was a woman talking to her daughter, that it sort of plays into the fact that, like, women are expected more to get into to fight with words. You know, they're not expected to have, like, physical fights. I think, you know, this is a situation where I think it would change the tenor of the cartoon slightly, but not change the entire meaning.
Also, it's like such a Brooklyn, it's like a Brooklyn dad, and I think a Brooklyn mom would be like, you go hit them.
Let me tell you, that advice does not get you many friends on Brooklyn playground.
You don't live in the most snobby neighborhood in Brooklyn, and I do.
Right. Use your words to tell that kid to go fuck himself.
A similar note, I drew the cartoon when the phrase war on women was in the news, and it was a woman sitting at the kitchen table and a little girl standing up looking at her, and she says, Mommy, what did you do in the war on women? And nobody didn't buy it, and I submitted again, they didn't buy it, so I finally gave up and published it online. And then like several months later, I decided, I'm going to draw this with a man at the table, like, Daddy, what did you do in the war on women? And I sent it to the New Yorker, and they bought it. But then they searched the internet, and saw that I'd done the other one, they said this is too close, so they didn't buy it. They bought it. But I thought it was an interesting gender thing.
Did you get paid to publish it on the internet or just self-publish
it? No, I think it was self-published. Oh, I forget, I gave it to some
I've site. Heard that that's okay.
This is a cartoon that I did actually based on life, like Mom's Dance. When my daughter was around 16, she was doing her homework in the living room, and you know, when your kid is a certain age, the sight of your adult body is disgusting to them. I kind of understand that, but I basically agree with it. But if you want to really gild that lily, you just do a little kind of dance. So I wanted to see if she was paying attention. She had some music going on in the boombox. She tells me how long ago this was. And so I, you know, kind of just was doing this little kind of dance, and she actually looked up and she said, "Mom, stop. You're hurting me." And I asked her if I could use it as a line.
Did you pay her?
In love. Right.
Yeah.
I'm trying to decide between water and sunlight. I feel like that a lot. I feel like I always have all these like intense worry like problems, and I'm trying to decide like. I don't know, and I think living in the city, like, do I work in this cafe where someone's going to bump into my elbow every 10 seconds, or do I sit at home where, like, someone is lying on the couch right next to where I work, or do I pay $1 billion and get my own apartment and work there?
I'm sorry, I don't know what those words are over there. Ignore those. I don't know why they're there. Birkin. Oh, this is Rayma, obviously. And I'd love to hear your take on this. I wish she was here. She does it. She can explain this.
Is this a take up on the Seurat?
Yes, I looked it up. I looked that part up, yeah. It has a title, actually. It's about something. Burkini. I think the title of the slide is Burkini. Well, maybe we don't have to decide.
Can we get it in art school critique? I think, well, it's pretty. I don't really know if it's, like, I mean, it has a lot of narrative in it.
It looks like she's sitting on a patch of melting ice, so maybe it's about melting polar ice caps. Maybe this is the North Pole and 100 years.
Can we just call her?
I like the dog.
The dog. I think that might be the French band Bourbon. Yeah.
This is the 2016 Advent calendar, and the caption is, "We're crying out loud, another turd." I got some pushback on this. A lot of people thought it was somehow a slam on Advent calendars. and not a note, like, you know, nod to the fact that, especially at the end of 2016, was like an extraordinarily, you know, it's been super shitty. For what it's worth, I ran this by my priest, and she said it was just fine.
Always wanted to see an advent calendar.
We can go to a dollar store and get advent calendars after this.
They're
kind of
great.
They are kind of great. We don't have them in my house because my daughter would eat all of it all at once. We're not good. My daughter would. Since the election kind of brought us a terrible new turd.
Yeah, this is true.
Yeah. So this was something I did for the Daily, when I was doing the Daily cartoon for the New Yorker site. And those, even though I don't consider myself a political cartoonist, I feel like those
were political by dint of they were supposed to be topical, and what else is there to talk about right now? So
it looked fine.
Thank you.
Thanks.
It looks like it should be like a 4-year advent calendar. Yeah.
It just ends in death.
Yeah.
I guess the one of the tropes of European cartoons is the Carnival of Love cartoon, so that's the MRI love.
I love their faces so much.
You make that kind of face fairly often in your cartoons, so people are very upset.
Yes, but I'm such a serene person.
Yeah. The finger knife swim team quit.
Here is confirmation bias is a hell of a drug. This was also for Adela because your particular online media bubble sort of like feeding into your own sense of outrage no matter where you are on the spectrum is it's seductive and awful, and that's why we're all going to die of heart attacks.
TVs until like a couple of years ago. First of all, we didn't get rid of our cathode set until like Christmas.
I haven't seen a new TV.
They're really boring to draw. The old ones are much more interesting. I don't know, it's just a flat square.
I love drawing the backs of TV sets because I make up all kinds of shit.
Right.
I have no idea, just like grids and like plugs and.
Nobody's going to challenge you really on that either.
No, because who looks at the back of the TV set? It's like, yeah, it's there.
Later, we'll watch the Bjork taking a TV set apart.
But I miss drawing the antennas because those were such a good visual element, and they were funny.
Yeah.
They were so weird. They were just...
I didn't know that TVs had something on the back until just now.
They're fun. Lots of fun to draw because it's sort of like drawing a robot. Just kind of put a lot of nonsense in
there. I'm going to move through the last few slides more quickly just so that we can get to questions if people would like to ask questions.
The caption here is, I need something sturdy enough to withstand the scrutiny of other parents. But helmets. There is no helmet. That's true.
Are there more women cartoonists now than in the past? Do you guys have a sense of that?
More come in.
More come into the office?
Yeah.
Number?
I think there are more. I mean, it's still not it's still not, nothing approaching equitable, but I mean, I think the more glaring issue is that there are so few women, well, people of color being bought or submitting. Like, I think that's that's a much bigger problem at this point.
It's a double-edged sword. I mean, even with women, it's like they haven't been bought, but they also haven't been submitting. So
yeah,
that's true with people of color.
It's like such a small world that that more people submit if their friends are submitting, but we should be doing more outreach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I have to say, I edited last year the best American comics for 2016, and it was more like graphic novel, like narrative type stuff. And I was given about 130 submissions, which I narrowed down to about 30. And at the end, just out of curiosity, I wanted to see, like, you know, how many were men and how many were women. Because I went through it and I really just picked the stuff I liked. And it wound up being almost 50-50. And I think it was like 14 to 16 or 15 to 17 or something like that. And that made me really happy. You know, I just thought, well, but then I also wonder whether just the narrative form, graphic novels, is more, I don't know, it's maybe because it's a newer form and people are it's more inventive, it's more open, whereas with the New Yorker cartoon, there still is this idea that it's one panel and there's a gag line, although I don't really do that very much. There's still that format, and I don't know.
The New Yorker always had women cartoonists from the beginning. I did a book about it, and
Helen Wilkinson and Mary Petty.
In 1925, the New Yorker had women cartoonists, and I interviewed Lee Lorenz, who was the cartoon editor before our current one, and Roz and I came in under Lee Lorenz, and I interviewed him for the book, and he said, because he brought Roz in, he brought myself in, and he brought Mary Carlin, and there were three women drawing cartoons at the time in the late 70s. And he said he wasn't looking for women cartoonists or cartoonists for women. He was looking for different ways to express humor. And by opening up the doors of what is standard for humor in any form, you get more diversity. So I think that's why he bought your work, because your work is different at the time. My work was different. So anyway, it's interesting.
It's nothing to do with being female at all.
Is it a male or a female?
The pigeons, they just kind of, you know, go between
gender fluid.
They're birds.
They're all dudes. General store. We now carry items. Yes, we take money.
She's wearing a t-shirt that says, "I regret only calling half of you deplorable." What we're all feeling. She is wearing a styrofoam little finger. And nothing, because why on earth would she want to subject herself to that fucking shit show or something to that?
This is a multi-panel. I thought you were gone. we do laundry, and I always have a sock left over, and my husband always tells me, just put it in the sock drawer, and eventually it will be reunited. And it is amazing how often, I mean, he's right, you know, about it. But it's weird. It's just weird how that happens. Although, this is boring. I can't believe we're talking about it. Like, have you ever had this thing where, like, the sock is lost, it's sad, it's like, you'll never see it again. And then, like, months later, you're like unfolding like a fitted sheet, and there's like a sock in the corner. But Lee Lorenz once told me a dryer story. There should actually be a magazine called Dryer Story. But he said that.
Months, you know, of figuring out how you want to
started or what you want to say exactly, and you know, you start it and you think this is right, this is good, and then you get into it and you know, months of work can be, you know, just thrown away because it's just not right. So you know, with a cartoon, you know, you work on it, you might work on it for half an hour and or whatever, and you see that it's going wrong, and there's, you know, you might throw it away or put it in the, you know, to be thought out later pile or whatever.
I think that you, with a cartoon, you know right away if it's good, like you feel if it's good or not. And a book, there's so many different things involved, and also you're not getting feedback very often, at least if you're like, I don't know, if you don't maybe have an agent or editor that you trust, which is how I was working earlier on. Like, these are things you need to build towards that, like I just never know if I'm making good work or not when I'm making a comic, and I think I will know 5 years from now. It's just a much longer process. It's like a craft. It's kind of, I don't know. Yeah.
No other questions?
Okay, further.
And thank you all for this is a great talk. And throughout the years, I think, especially at comics conventions, there have been a lot of sort of this genre of panel about women's issues in the industry and what the current state of women in comics is. Do you think that there's a point where we won't have these panels anymore because it won't be remarkable to be a woman working in comics? Or do you think, as you started off the panel by saying, do you think it's always going to be political to be a woman in comics?
I would love there to not be, yeah. I would love it to not be an issue.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, if being a woman is a political act, I think it's because, you know, things are still, you know, because of the, you know, bad things that can happen to women in society. I mean, that was a really clumsily phrased thing. But, like, I feel like if we can get beyond those things happening, that it will become less and less. I would like to live in a society where it was not a political act to be female.
Yeah, I wonder if this festival and this panel is less about the fact that we're women in comics and cartoons, and more about how we express issues about gender in the world, you know? I think until, like somebody said, we have leaders who are less homophobic and sexist, then things will get better, and editors and people who run the organizations that own the publications and are more open-minded, then we'll have fewer problems. Yeah.
Hi. Yes, I'm wondering now that Bob has left as of, I think, a week ago, and now a new cartoon editor is coming in who, one, is not a cartoonist from what I understand, and is a woman, Ellen, I'm not sure if I was saying it, Ellen. What do you anticipate, or, you know, thoughts you have about this change, or do you, as an issue or possibilities?
I'm hopeful. I mean, why not? You know, I've met her. She seems great. I've worked with only two editors, cartoon editors, before her. And Sean Gottlieb, Tina Brown, David, four editors of the magazine. And in some ways, it's all the same. It's still, you know, I know I'm just going to be doing my batches, and I'm going to be submitting, and I'll go on like streaks of selling, and then I'll have streaks of like not selling. And I don't anticipate, I hope that, you know, it won't suddenly be like, well, we're not using cartoons anymore, or we hate you, or, you know, whatever thing. So I'm just hoping, I don't anticipate anything like radically being so different from that. It's kind of,
relate in some ways to, you know, people say, oh, the New Yorker was so much, you know, the cartoons were so much funnier back in the past. But actually, if you look at issues of the New Yorker in the past, there seems to be a sort of, you know, if there's like 15 cartoons, there'll be like two or three that I adore, and two or three that I'm like, eh. And then the rest are sort of like, oh, you know, these are decent jokes, you know, not my favorites, but they're, you know, they're sort of hoping that I don't anticipate anything really radically, you know, hopefully, knock on wood.
Thank you.
Yeah. Just a process question. Do you conceive the joke first and then visualize it, or do you kind of have a moment where you see a joke and then you find the words to fit it?
It's a process question. I'm sorry, I didn't repeat the other questions. I forgot to do it. She wants to know what comes first, the joke or the drawing, or some combination.
For me, it's the idea. I have to have an idea. I mean, I doodle a lot, and once in a while, I'll get, I'll get an idea from a doodle, but most of the time I have some idea of a joke that I want to draw up. You know, when the New Yorker started publishing cartoons, they actually, they didn't call them cartoons, they called them idea drawings. And that's sort of what they are. I mean, they're kind of like, you have an idea of what's funny, and or that's what I do. I have an idea of something that I want to draw about, and then it might take a while to sort of figure out how to do that, but the idea,
my daughter calls me a painter jokester. That's totally what I'm putting on my test.
When my son was little, and he was about three or four, no, he must have been before three, because we're still living in Brooklyn. Anyway, I asked him what he thought I did for a living, and he said, "You go on the subway and you show your drawings to the men." And I said, "Yeah, that's right." Hey, honey.
One more question? You have one? If not, I think that's a great way to end. Show the cartoons to the men. Not anymore. Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you, panelists.